für das Let's Play of Homeworld Cataclysm. I'm doing this Let's Play because I really, really love Cataclysm. And, well, how do I start? Well, first off, it was surprisingly easy to make the game work on my computer, so, well, I even got the second highest resolution, the highest made the game crash. And here I'm kind of fiddling around with the options and stuff, and then I started training, so you can see a bit more during this little introduction video. And sorry, I only just now noticed the stupid cursor was right in the middle of the view the entire time. And yes, this is Cataclysm. The real second part to Homeworld. As you can hear and possibly read, this is the German version of Cataclysm because, well, I didn't have the English version and there was apparently no option to install an English version from my German CD. So I'll try my best with what I have. It's after all for the casual LP thread on the Something Awful forums. So, well, it should go. It should go well. More or less. So here, in training, we are essentially learning how to play the game, for those, which is kind of nice for those who never played a Homeworld game before. It's quite simple. You listen to the voice in the left corner. You have the stuff you have to do, and if you forget what the voice is rambling on about, you can simply click on your goals and the voice talks a bit again. Here I try to get a good look on the ships we have right now. Our Recon ships. This is our mothership, the Kun Lan. And then I'm, well, just trying things out, trying to remember how I actually played the game. Well, what can I talk about?
Die Lektion ist jetzt abgeschlossen. Klicken Sie auf die Schaltfläche nächste Lektion,
okay.
Dann geht es weiter.
Let's do it like this, since describing how the game works in too much detail would be boring, I'll instead tell you a story.
Wenn Sie einen Befehl erteilen, betrifft
Cataclysm was one of the first RTS, well, one of the first PC games I ever played. It's quite funny because even as I started playing on the PC, I didn't even have that much interest to strategy games, or even to real-time strategy games like Cataclysm. It was simply something I didn't know about. Then one time I remember as a child playing Civilization, the first part, on an old Amiga computer by a friend. This is essentially what started everything, because several years later I actually found some kind of science fiction fan version of Civilization, which slowly got me interested in sci-fi games. Then I played Homeworld, the original, for a really short time again, at another friend's place, and the fact that everything was in 3D really fascinated me. And then, accidentally, after visiting a local shop, I suddenly saw Homeworld Cataclysm simply lying around. Fully German. And so I thought to myself, well, Homeworld looked nice and this seems to be some kind of Homeworld-like game. So I bought it. Well, and then I played the hell out of it, finished it, and then forgot about it. But I found it was a really great game, great story, really atmospheric. Well, a good game. So, well, we don't want to ignore the game we are looking at completely, so here we are seeing the sensor screen. Every time you press space, it comes up, or you can combat your way through the menus like I'm doing here, because I keep forgetting what was what. Well, to be short, everything in that blue sphere is active scan. You can see enemies, the red points, brown points are resources, and you see your own ships, green or large icons for battleships and model ships and something like that. The dark cube beyond the blue sphere is your passive scan. You see right there this red echo. This can happen even in the dark thing, the dark part of the scan thing. Essentially, every time you move around, your scan thingy moves around with your ship, so you can do recon and stuff. And let's just say you can get in really deep trouble if you say move ships around with small active scan radius and suddenly enemies appear left, right, above and below, because everything is three-dimensional. And that's it, really. It's kind of useful for large-scale operations, because sometimes you can't see enemies if they are too far away. And it's kind of nice to see in on the sensor screen where the enemy squadrons are actually coming from, so you can send them a little Archangel class-sized greeting. More info on ships as they turn up. So, what else? Well, let's start with the obvious. I made this little training video mostly so I could talk about all the stuff only tangentially related to the game, like the commentary. This commentary isn't in real time because of my weird setup and my recording software, and I had it happen more than one time that I recorded voice for about an hour and then suddenly noticed that I didn't actually start recording the game footage. So I nowadays make it kind of separate. First I make video footage, then I can look at it and make the commentary. So, and I will not only post videos but also stuff about the story, because the main part of Homeworld Cataclysm is the story, and there is a lot of it, even outside of the game itself. There is about 20 pages in my manual about the history of all the factions of Homeworld and of the Kief Somtar. A lot of story. It's kind of fascinating, so I will try to post about it, which means I have to search for the English language version, because all I have is German, and even more German. So, here you see a bit about the movement. You can make ships move directly, you can make waypoints, all that stuff. You can even let the ships move, as you have already seen, I suppose, above and below the ecliptic. So yeah, I don't know much about multiplayer because I never played it in multiplayer, but it's really, you can really surprise the AI sometimes by just moving below or above them. It's kind of funny actually. On the other hand, you can also make huge fuck-off walls out of your capital ships and then just plow right into them, and it's quite a massacre sometimes. But well, we will see in the actually game what how that works.
Well,
something else you may have noticed again in the corner left and down, there is something, a function that accelerates time. This time-lapse function allows you to essentially, well, sped up the game. It's kind of a suicide if you do it with lots of enemies around you, but it saves a lot of nerves if all you have left to do is collect resources. So one thing I almost forgot because I never actually played the first part. On the right side, down below, you see something called SE, your support units, or here in German, Support Einheiten. The green number is what you have right now, and this number will go up the more ships you build or collect from the enemy using your little worker ships. And the SE, SU in English on the right, is the support units you have in the entire fleet. You can up these numbers by building certain capital ships, carriers, that was it. But there is a certain border you cannot step over. So essentially your fleet limit is finite. You can't just catch and build units like there's no tomorrow. So at least the enemy AI has a fair chance on actually beating you. Under SU we have the research units, the resource units, or here resource Einheiten, the stuff you can collect by mining. And it's used up by research and by building stuff. Yeah. Now we are at the part of the training where I actually have to fire at something. So I move widely around and finally send my little fighters right to the targets. Here we finally see them again from close up. Sadly not for too long, since I'm really bad at controlling the camera. And then I finally send them against the targets and we start blowing stuff up. And in the next video this stuff can actually fight back. Right now it's just target practice. Man, I sure hope no one notices I keep looking up new worlds. Yes. One explosion after another. Quite relaxing. And if you look at my goals, I'm actually finished, so I could click and go on with the next lecture, but because I'm kind of obsessive, I'll only go one step beyond after destroying the last target.
Produktion läuft.
Yeah, and now the stuff I already talked about building ships. It's quite simple. I think it's essentially the same as building ships in Homeworld. Larger ships are built right next to your capital ships, to your mother ship especially, and small ships are built inside and then kind of expelled. There's the progress bar, left and up, slowly going through all ships. And you may have noticed I had the time-lapse function on, so we didn't actually spend minutes of our time looking at the progress bar. So the first working ships are there. Now we can actually send them mining. Oh, and we get a few ships, a destroyer and an enemy frigate. And this selection essentially just shows us we can use worker ships to repair other ships, we can use them to capture other ships, Beachten Sie, and we can use them for mining. And now I have actually already described everything which happens in the next minutes. But interesting to see, while that frigate isn't one of the ones we can buy, build, I mean, this destroyer is actually one of our later units. And here I keep forgetting to use time-lapse until far too late. So I guess I can go back to storytelling. Fun fact, I was actually quite baffled, really surprised after learning that there was actually a Homeworld Part 2. Because, you know, the entire history recorded in Cataclysm, story, manual and something, points out to Cataclysm being the sequel to Homeworld, and Homeworld 2, well, in my worldview, it just didn't fit in. I didn't even find it as much fun to play as Cataclysm, strangely enough. I think I have Homeworld 2 even lying around somewhere. I have to look it up. But back to Cataclysm. Essentially, Cataclysm starts about 15 years after the end of Part 1. If you actually played the first part, you know, the Higurians ons in a time where the Kushans from the planet Karak, until that word Empire of the Tidan decided they had all to die because they found this old ship, built a new hyperspace capable colony ship of their own, the Mother Ship of Part 1. And this was against the law. And so Karak was burned. All the old people on it died and so on and so on. Really tragic. Really tragic. The Mother Ship went on to travel through space, trying to find the old homeworld Higara, and it ended with, well, the crazy emperor getting blown up. Now the Kushans are named Higarans, they are back on their real homeworld, and the Keef Somta, Keef is apparently some fancy science fiction name for a clan or something, and the Somta are actually a quite important clan among the Higarans, but not many of them survived. Most of them stayed on Karak and were burned to a crisp, and the few that survived, well, let's just say it wasn't fun to learn that their entire families had died. There were even some of them around in Part 1, because some of the crews on the worker ships and other industrial units of your fleet in Part 1 were actually Somta. And in this place, in the last 15 years, there was political upheaval and lots of strife on Higara. And the Somta unified with some other, even smaller clans, and then finally were allowed to build their own capital ships using the giant mothership yard, the mothership Part 1 turned yard, in the orbit of Higara to build three ships. The Kun Lan is one of them. There is a second we will be meeting, another mining ship, and a research ship, the Klee Sun. All three ships will be an important part of this game. Sadly, I think only one really survives. Maybe. Let's just find out. Here I'm trying some of the formations for smaller ships, like the Claw or the Delta Formation X. X and Claw is right nice if you want to attack certain targets, like frigates or destroyers or other large ships, because those formations really concentrate the firepower of all your small ships. I never actually used Delta, so I can't say, well, it looks neat. That's all I can say about it. The standard formation is Phalanx, and it's, well, shit. That's all. Most of the time I even use X and Claw when I'm fighting other fighters. I think it's a bad idea, but, well, I couldn't bother with it. Besides, most of the game I remember playing turned out to be a huge fuck-off match because between large ships or fleets of capital ships duking it out. Like some space version of the Battle of Jutland in 1916. In Germany, the battle was called the Schlacht von Skagerrak. I have to say, it sounds better than the Battle of Jutland. And all of you who know nothing about the history of the First World War have now learned something. Yes, yes, Fleet Command or Leitstelle. I have no idea what I'm doing here right now. Yes, I was supposed to make a group out of my reconnaissance ships and my Vassal fighters. But I apparently had forgotten how this actually worked. It was Control plus... Oh god, what was this word again? Yes, it was drawing a frame around the ships you want to have and then pressing Control and the number of the group you want to have. Then you just press the number and have the group always ready. Can't even remember if I ever did it. I suppose so, but most of the time I just used whatever. Yes, my red group of fighters and reconnaissance ships is still ambling around the few waypoints I made, and I still obsessively mine stuff I can't actually need because this is just training and has nothing to do with the game. This is actually the only low point I have found so far, because if you remember part 1, the tutorial was actually integrated into the story. This time it's kind of just there. You have your training, you do your stuff, and if your training is over, then all this will never have happened. Well, I suppose you could try to shoehorn it into the story, but it's a bit of a stretch. Then again, my memory is a bit hazy. After all, it's about 20 years or something like... Was it 14 years? When was this again? Oh, okay, it was about 13 years, I guess. It's from 2000, and sometime between 2001 and 2002 I bought the game and played it. So yeah, something like 12 to 13 years ago. So, well, let's see in the next video if I was completely wrong or not. Just in case I forget to mention it later, here I entirely try upgrading units, because with the power of technology and the right research you can combine two Vassal fighters into one corvette. Double the firepower, double the fun. It's kind of quite interesting, because if you have researched this technology, you essentially never have to build the corvettes, because you can build fighters, and if it turns out you need a little bit more firepower, you can simply, well, combine your fighters into corvettes. Easy peasy. Here we are trying out the tactical overlay, something I also have forgotten, so I'm trying around like an idiot for a while until I finally find the right options. Ah, there. So this overlay essentially makes it a bit easier to see what you're actually looking at. What is a fighter, what is a frigate, stuff like that. If there are dozens upon dozens of units flying widely around through three-dimensional space, it's kind of neat to have. I think I tend to forget this this overlay exists a lot. But well, it well, you know, I try to make the other goals. Ah yes, I try to try to select a single reconnaissance ship, and then we are trying the first person pilot view. It's kind of neat, I guess. Of course, an actual battle is also kind of stupid. But in a longer mission, sometimes it can be fun if you want to recon something, some faraway place. You kind of send a ship or a unit and then select it and then switch to first person mode. And you feel like a real pilot, I guess. So now I have to actually destroy one of my ships. This little one, my poor little victim. The last two options left, I guess. Self-destruction and what was? Ah yes, the word was scrapping. We already scrapped a ship while I was talking like someone not very smart. Oh god, my English is bad. Well, that was it mostly. The tutorial is over, and in the next video we actually start playing the game. So, this was Libluini. I'm finished.